words and my mouth and meditation of our hearts. Find acceptance in your sight, O Lord, who are our strength and our healing. May your eyes be open and may the entrance of your word bring light. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. Amen. Good morning, brothers and sisters.
Good morning.
The scripture lessons that were read are quite familiar, I know. But what is interesting is oftentimes when we take a second look at what we're familiar with, sometimes some new things appear. And the Old Testament reading, the one in Daniel, it's rather unique in the context in which we find ourselves and the context in which we find ourselves. And this is what I mean. Daniel, as you know, was taken as a captive, as an exile, into Babylon. So he was in Babylon by force. But Daniel and his other three friends, they got some privilege. They were able to study at the University of Babylon. Oh, you know, right? At the Royal College, at the Institute of Science, Literature, Astrology, and Futurology. An eminently qualified man. He was multilingual. He learned the language and literature of the Chaldean. And his native tongue was Hebrew. Why am I saying all of this? I'm saying all of this because Daniel is probably one of the most eminent persons we meet in scripture. Daniel and his friends graduated top of the class. And the examiner, which was Nebuchadnezzar himself, said that they were 10 times better than his existing staff members, our team. That's a good resume to have. So Daniel comes eminently qualified. In fact, Daniel is unique in this. Daniel is the only administrator in scripture that has actually run three world empires. Babylon, Medes, and Persia. He survived of the first year of Cyrus. Okay. So Daniel is not an ordinary fellow. In our time, Daniel would have letters behind his name competing with the alphabet. Are you with me? So he didn't just understand the science. He understood literature. He understood astrology. He understood the arts of the Babylonians. Are you? Now, the challenge we have with a situation like that is Daniel is so educated, so trained, and yet his way of solving a complex problem is to pray. Isn't it interesting? You see, when Daniel came into Babylon, he came into an advanced civilization. There was nothing in Jerusalem that was advanced as the art and the culture and the literature and the architecture and the engineering of Babylon. In fact, the Hanging Garden is known to be one of the seven wonders of the world. Can you imagine the awe and wonder that these Israelite exiles experienced when they came into this land? And yet, for all that, the philosophy on which Babylon was built was an idolatrous philosophy. Their gods were silver and gold. Isn't it interesting? How can persons so advanced, so bright, having such development in art and literature and culture and science, be so wrong about their philosophy? Something must be right about it. And isn't that the way we view others? He can't be so brilliant and be wrong that there is no God. So the new atheist philosophy, driven by eminent intellectuals, dazzle our eyes because we're saying they're so bright, if their society is so advanced, then they must be right. Well, I'll share with you. Well, in my younger days, my grandma used to talk to me. And of course, I, you know, tried to have my own way. So she would say to me, "You think you are right, but you are wrong." In other words, a lot of what the world shows us as the right thing is so wrong. It doesn't matter how advanced it is. It doesn't matter how advanced it gets them. It doesn't matter the engineering behind it, science behind it. If it is based on an idolatrous philosophy, it cannot stand. Everybody alright so far? So that's Daniel. Now, Daniel, and what's interesting to note, the first verse of chapter 2 said that this was the second year of Nebuchadnezzar. Now, do you remember how long they sit the course at the University of Babylon in chapter 1? 3 years. Work with me now. 3 years. This was the second year of Nebuchadnezzar. It doesn't mean that Nebuchadnezzar was on his throne for only 2 years. No. It means the second year when the Israelites, including Daniel, came to Babylon. Everybody alright with that? Which means that Daniel would have been a student at this time when this situation was occurring. So Daniel didn't yet graduate. The king had a dream, and it says that the dream was of such nature that his spirit troubled him and his sleep left him. What an awful dream. That's like a nightmare. I don't know if anybody ever had a dream like that, where you wake up and you see the part. That's what Nebuchadnezzar faced. And you would know that Nebuchadnezzar dreamt that he saw a figure looking like a man, a statue, with different metals, gold for the head, and silver for the chest, and bronze, and gold, silver, bronze, and clay, all the way down. At each level, the value of the metal gets less and less. But something interesting happened in the dream. A hand cut a rock from a mountain and hit the toes of the statue, and the whole statue crumbled. Now, reason with me. If you were Nebuchadnezzar, you were the head of a superpower, and you got a dream like that, what would you be thinking? Could it mean? What would that mean for my power to be crumbling, and the stone that hit the statue itself fill up the entire earth? But that was supposed to be Babylon. Babylon was the kingdom that filled the entire earth. So Nebuchadnezzar recognized that something about this dream is ominous. Something about this dream don't seem to be going in my favor. So what did he do? He called his think tank, his economic advisors, his forecasters, his luminaries. We have them everywhere. They're in Congress, they're in cabinet, they're in ministers. Yeah, every kingdom has to happen. So, but Nebuchadnezzar called his think tank. No, I mean, I'm just guessing. I'm not sure if he waited until the morning, you know. Because here's the king, his sleep left him, and he needs to know the answer. So he said, call his wise men. His wise men came, and of course, why are they wise? They're wise because they know how to process information and analyze data. Are you with me? But you have to give them something. Are you with me? You have to give them the train. You have to give them the data. You have to accumulate some facts for them. But Nebuchadnezzar didn't do it this time. Why wouldn't Nebuchadnezzar tell his wise men this dream? You ever thought about that? Why? Can you imagine if Nebuchadnezzar told his wise men, these are men who understood information and data and how to analyze and forecast, they could surmise that this could be a signal of Nebuchadnezzar's demise. So what could they do? They could easily conspire to get rid of Nebuchadnezzar. That's the reason why Nebuchadnezzar didn't tell him the dream. So Nebuchadnezzar said, I have a dream, but you have to tell me the dream. And in addition, you have to tell me the interpretation. Make sense? And that's where all the intellectual brilliance and the eminent qualification of these gentlemen came to a stop. Isn't it interesting that education can only bring you so far and no more? Are you with me? Because there is an access point to information that is beyond education. It's called revelation. And that is real. You see, when we talk about revelation, people think you have to be this anti-intellectual person. This person who don't know anything, or who is ignorant. Again, Daniel's resume. No, the wise men said, King, okay, give us the information. And the king says in verse 5, my decision is firm. If you do not make known to me the dream and its interpretation, you shall be cut in pieces and your bones shall be made as an ash heap. What? That doesn't make any sense to rational, reasonable, experienced, intellectual people who are royal advisors. Are you with me? So, of course, they would have protested. And they said, okay, if you tell us the dream, then we can tell you, we will tell you the interpretation of it. And then Nebuchadnezzar insisted, and they made a statement, which is in verse 10, which is rather, 10 and 11, which is rather interesting. The Chaldeans answered the king and said, there is not a man on earth who can tell the king this matter. You hear that? There's not a man on earth who can tell the king that matter. Therefore, no king, or lord, or ruler, has ever asked such thing of any magician, astrologer, or Chaldeans. You see, these are reasonable guys. So they say, okay, king, no man can explain or give the answer for what you're asking about. Not only that, when we check the royal records, no king has ever made such a request of their advisors. Oh my. They're making their case, aren't they? That's what reasonable and rational people do. Make a case. And it's a compelling case. So there is no precedent to this. Why would it be important to reference a precedent? Because every act of a king is an act of law. So if no king has made such a request, there is no precedent in law. Therefore, we're out of hope. Nebuchadnezzar didn't think so. In fact, they're saying, just to the third point, just to clarify, just to explain to you how difficult and impossible this thing is. They said in verse 11, it is a difficult thing that the king requires, and there is no other who can tell it to the king except the gods. And listen to this part. Whose dwelling is not with flesh. No, no, no. Listen to what the next verse says. For this reason, for saying this, the king was so angry and furious that he gave a command to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. That seemed to be a little bit excessive to me. Is it really? Is it really? If you are a king and you're bankrolling these economic advisors who has been telling you that they have access to information from anywhere, and now they're admitting that you never had information at all, what would you do if you're as angry and ignorant or poor as the Nebuchadnezzar? You'd scream, hello. Hello. Thank God for Jesus. So all along, they were posing as medium of information from anywhere. And now they had to admit that we don't have access. to this information. So Nebuchadnezzar said, you guys have been lying to me all your career. Your entire career has been one big lie. Getting rid of all of it. So it was excessive. Nebuchadnezzar was angry, furious, that his wise men didn't have any access to any information. They were just analyzing data and making a probable forecast. And they were using trends to predict strong correlations. How many times did you say that the economy comes and shakes? It's about to grow this year. It's about to grow. It's going to take off now. The economy is stable. You're poised for growth. Have you ever forecast? Yeah, man. Why is that? But God alone is wise. He alone is wise. Are you with me? But what we do, we trust in the wisdom of men more than in the wisdom of God. Why? Because the wisdom of God seems to be foolishness to us. We can't make sense of it. So here, Nebuchadnezzar said, all wise men, death sentence. And Arioch, who was the general in charge of the execution, start killing the wise men. Obviously, Daniel and his friends were not in the same in the palace, because said the king went over to Daniel and said, Daniel, I have the sentence of death for you. It says, when Arioch came to Daniel, this is interesting, Arioch had a command from the king, this is an act of law. No civilian can turn back the word of the king. And he said to verse 14, then with counsel and wisdom, Daniel answered Arioch, the captain of King Gar, who had gone to kill the wise men, and he answered and said to Arioch, why is the decree from the king so urgent? Then Arioch made the decision known to Daniel. Now what is it? You wake up in the middle of the night. A soldier comes to your door and says, I come to kill you. What would you do? What would you do? Well, those who run would want to ask, why me? What have I done? You want to think, is it something personal that Arioch has against me? We would just take it and make it to one big personal basket problem. Isn't that what we, you see, we sometimes are so selfish, and even the problems, we take them on for ourselves. It wasn't Daniel's problem, it was everybody's problem. Are you with me? So the economy is not growing, it's not your personal problem, it's not the economy. It's not growing for everybody. Are you with me? If there's a famine in the land and you're hungry, what is hungry, you know, why do you take on the whole famine on your stomach? You see, we take on things so personal, and so we can't see the big picture. No temptation that overtakes you is such as it's uncommon to mankind. But God is faithful, Richard. And He won't allow you to be tested beyond what you're able. So Daniel's faith that death sentence in the middle of the night. Oh my gosh. What a wake of God. And by the way, he's a student. And he's doing well in class. What was Daniel's response? Then Daniel made verse 16. So Daniel went in and asked the king to give him time that he might tell the king the interpretation. Daniel, are you crazy? Daniel said, okay, let me talk to the king. So of course Arioch would have escorted Daniel because he's supposed to die. And Daniel said to the king, King, your majesty, could you give me some time? I'll come back to you with an answer. Oh, what confidence! What is it that could give Daniel that kind of confidence? You don't even know the dream, and you're promising that you'll come back with the dream plus the interpretation. All you want is your own time. When you're facing more problems, how do you approach it? Do you approach with the kind of confidence that says, "All I need is just some time. The bills are due. All I need is just some time. Yeah, you can only call the bank. Just give me some time. It's so clear. back in the family. That's kind of audacity. The man living life with honor. What would give him that kind of audacity? Because he's living life with intention and purpose and commitment. In chapter 1, verse 8 says that he had purpose in his heart how he was going to live. He was so committed and intentional about his life. He wasn't uncertain about the source of his help. Are you with me? So Daniel did the first thing. Daniel did something else. The second thing it says in verse 17. Then Daniel, so after Daniel asked him for more time, verse 17 says, then Daniel went into his house and made the decision known to Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, his companions. I don't think you understand what I'm saying now. I don't think you understand what I'm saying. Four of us sharing a door. The king has a problem. Nobody can solve the problem. Daniel took it upon his head. This side, I carry the problem home. And they said, alright, come go pray. No, you can imagine. You can imagine. Huh? Your husband comes and come and say, sister, this side's going to go back to the house. And I'm going to go pray. We're going to buy a piece of property. I tell him to send over the papers. I'm going to pay the deposit next week. But we want everybody to come to pray about it now. Hello. It means both of you are on the same page. Are you with me? You can imagine. You can imagine the head of the committee here inside. And they call the committee members and say, go to the war brothers and sisters. Don't cost 4 million. I'll ask the clock and the carpet to start. And they're going to start Monday. We don't have a church meeting. And you're like, yeah, but let's pray. Since we meet, let's pray now. That don't make no sense. No brothers and sisters. It don't make any sense. Well, that's what Daniel did. Daniel made a decision and was so confident about it. And he was so confident about the page his brethren were on that he could have taken it home and said, let us pray. Let us seek the mercies of God concerning this matter.
Amen. Amen.
But what is interesting about it, remember that these guys, their lives are hanging in the balance. It's not like you owe a bill and you can skip it and pay it next month. In the morning, your life is gone. You need to go back to the king. And it says in verse 19, then the secret was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. So Daniel blessed the God of heaven. And the verse following is the prayer that he prayed. It says, the dream, the secret was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. Just pause it. It's so low, just pause it. How could Daniel get the secret revealed in a night vision? What would he have had to be doing to be getting, huh? What would have had to be doing what?
Sleeping.
Sleeping. Sorry. He must be sleeping. Are you with me? The man have a problem with costing his life in the morning. Pray and go in bed and sleep. That's the kind of confidence I'm talking about. In the God that you serve. You have a problem, you don't pray about it, and you can't sleep. I don't know which God is that. It's not the God of Daniel. Are you with me? You have a problem that can cost your life in the morning. You pray about it with your prayer partners, and you're going to sleep. That's it. It finished. That's the kind of audacity and confidence that God wants to come forward to you with, you know. You see, that's some problem. It's like, we take it as long-term insurance. We don't expect to be solved right now. The scripture didn't tell us what they prayed, but the answer to the prayer mentioned that they prayed about it. They asked that this secret would have been revealed to them. The point I'm trying to get across, I mean, you can read the rest of the chapter, it makes excellent reading. The point I'm trying to make from all of this, and the subject of what I really want to bring home, is that we should walk in the light. Walk in the light. Nebuchadnezzar got a dream in the night, and he could shed no light on it. Neither could any of his wise men. Now let me say something about it a bit. You ever talk to somebody and they said, I never see it in that light. Or, I don't want you to see me in that light. What are you talking about? want light. Because the light in which you see determines what you see. Are you with me? The light that is guiding the wise men caused them to see nothing. No one can reveal it. The light that Daniel was in was able to reveal it to him. C.S. Lewis makes a point. I want to just mention briefly. He says, I believe in Christianity as I believe in the sun, that the sun has risen. Not only because I see it, but because by it I see everything. He says he believes in his faith in as much as he believes that the sun has risen. Not because he sees the sun, but that because in the sun, by the sun, he sees everything. Do you see everything by the light of your faith or only some things? Only church things? Do you see all of your life in the light of your faith? Or is it just some things? Jesus says in Matthew 6, the light of the body is the eye. And if the eye is single, I'm using the King James Version translation, if the eye is single, the body will be full of light. Now, I tried for years to understand that never. The light of the body is the eye. And if the eye is single, the body will be full of light. Well, let's just get something straight. It didn't say the light of the body is the eyes, plural. The NIV, I know, over-translates to say plural eyes. But it says the light of the body is the eye. So it's not talking about your two physical eyes. It's a metaphor for something. The Berean Study Bible puts it this way. Where the King James says, if your eye is single, your body will be full of light. The Berean translation says, if your vision is clear, your body will be full of light. So, when it talks about the light of the body, the eye, you've got two eyes. There might be a third eye. In fact, you don't even need eyes to see. I know I'm way up the deep end. Hold on, let's see that. But it's Absalom, when Saul fell off his high horse on the Damascus Road, when he came in contact with the light, he was blinded. But then he got a vision that Ananias was going to visit him and all that was going to happen afterwards. Saul never needed eyes to see. Are you with me? Nebuchadnezzar was using his physical eyes when he got the dream. So there is a way of seeing that is not the physical eye. And brothers and sisters, let me explain something to you. When you read the scriptures, try to meditate and read the inner meaning of it. And it will become clear. So when Jesus says, I am the door, does it mean he's a 6x4 mahogany plank? Wooden door? Absolutely not. But what does a door do? A door gives you access to somewhere, isn't it? So if Jesus is going to say, I am the door, it means he's the access to somewhere. If Jesus said, I am the way, doesn't mean that he's asphalt on the road. What does a way do? A way guides your feet to a particular destination. Are you with me? If he says, I am a shepherd, it doesn't mean he's living a physical pasture. It means he is a caregiver and a guide. So when we get into the metaphor of what the things mean, it becomes clearer. So we have an eye that can give light to the body, but the eye must be singular. It must be focused. So if your vision is focused on the light, then your body will have light. The way to get light inside of you is through the eye, not the physical eye. Talking about vision. So let me just give us some quick references and then close. Let's turn to John, Gospel of John chapter 1. And then we'll just talk to you the next few minutes. John chapter 1. question we have to ask ourselves is there any light that is guiding your life? We saw the light that was guiding Daniel and his friend's life. The kind of light that could shed light on dark ring, a dark problem, that could shed light on it. This is what John 1 says. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Listen carefully. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through Him, and without Him, nothing was made that was made. Pause. This beginning is Genesis 1. In Genesis 1, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the earth. And God said, He spoke, and when God spoke, what happened? Let there be light. So you realize that the Word is light. You get it? God spoke His Word, and light came. So the Word is synonymous with light, which is what John is saying in verse 4. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Moving on further, it says, verse 6, there was a man sent from God, his name was John. This man came to be a witness to the light, that all through him might believe. He was not the light, but was sent to be a witness to the light. Look at verse 9. That was the true light, which gives light to every man who comes into the world. Did you know that you need light to lead your life? Because the world, by default, is dark. That's what it was in the beginning. It's dark and it's chaotic, just like Genesis 1. So in order to navigate in the world that we find ourselves, we need light. And it says that the Word is the light. What is interesting as well is this light. What is this light that we're talking about? Just write this down. John chapter 8 verse 12. This is Jesus talking. John chapter 8 verse 12. Jesus said, then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. So it's explicitly clear who is the light of the world. And He comes to give light to every man, every human being that comes into the world. Everybody okay with that? So, in order to understand how light functions, let me give you an example that Jesus used. And it's found in John chapter 11. John chapter 11. And this is an episode, I'll just read verses 9 and 10. But the verses leading up, it's a story of Jesus being called to go visit Mary and Martha, whose brother Lazarus was sick. And so Jesus stayed a little while longer. And when Jesus, verse 6, so when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, later the Jews sought to stone you, and are you going there again? Jesus answered, listen carefully, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world, which is the sun. Alright? And then Jesus says, but if one walks in the night, he stumbles. Why? Because the light is not in him. Brothers and sisters, light is not in us. We're not self-luminous beings. Light is not in you. So stop searching for light inside of you. That's what the New Age philosophy tried to tell you. There's light in you, just search for it. There's nothing lost inside of you. It's you who are lost. and need to be formed by Jesus. Get it straight. So there's no light inside of you to find. Because Jesus says, you can't even walk straight in the night because you have no light inside you. So this is Paul's second verse. That is his point. Jesus used the example that there are 12 hours in the day. And if you walk in the day, you can walk okay because the light of the world guides you. So let this come on a bit. When you're using light, how do you use light? Well, you use light exactly the same way you use the sun. Have you ever stopped to realize that the sun is not in our world? The sun is in another world. The sun is not in our atmosphere. If the sun were here, it would absorb all the oxygen in our atmosphere. We just suffocate and die. Let alone the heat. So the light is above us, outside of our world. That's how it guides us when we live our physical lives. Well, the same thing applies spiritually. Spiritual light operates like that. Spiritual light is not inside of you. It is in another world. And it's above you. You must have to realize that if you want to benefit from light, you have to put it above you. You can't put light below the feet and expect to see anything on the table. So light either must be positioned above you or in front of you. That's why your head now is in front of you. Are you with me? Head on jam the brake light. That's how light benefits you. It has to be in front of you or above you. Well, that is how spiritual light works as well. The light of God has to be above you and it has to be in front of you. That's how light functions. And what is it that we need in order to see? Light, not eyes. And you might say, but that eyes I can see. No. If you have eyes and you're in a dark room, you're just as good as blind. So what you need in order to see is light, not eyes. And if we're going to see beyond this world in order to guide our lives in it, then we need the light of God. What does light do? Light. If you look at the perspective from which the sun comes from, the sun is over everything. So light gives you oversight. The scripture word for it would be vision. There can't be a vision without light. If you don't have the light of God in you, you can't see anything from God. In fact, the prophets were called seers in olden times. So they're able to see because they have the light of God inside of them. So light gives you oversight, this vision. Once you're able to see from that perspective, then that oversight gives you insight, otherwise called revelation. So it's oversight, which is vision, insight, which is revelation. And insight now gives you foresight. And in scripture we call it prophecy. Get it? But none of that will be possible without light. So you can't see from the higher level without light. In that case, your vision is off. So instead of oversight, you're seeing things from sideways. It's just a natural view. And that has its own limitations because you can't see beyond your range of vision. And oftentimes, our problems come to us like that. You have to see from God's perspective. And if you see from oversight, you'll get insight and revelation in order to do something about it. So, with light, we see vision and get revelation from God that can give us foresight or wisdom to guide our lives. Let me close with this, brothers and sisters. the Gospel of John, which we're looking at now, is called the Book of Signs. The Book of Signs. And there are seven signs which John speaks of. So the first sign, which is the water turning to wine, the miracle, the wedding feast of Cana in John chapter 2. Let me first let it say, these are the beginnings of the signs that Jesus did. When you read John chapter 4, which is the feeding of the healing of the sick, the nobleman's son, it says this is the second sign. So you actually said nothing. And John concludes his book in terms of the thesis statement I want to call it, John chapter 20, verse 30 and 31. He says, and truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. So the book of John is a book of signs. Now, what is a sign? What's a sign? A sign, to put it very simply, a sign is something that points to something else. So a sign is not the thing. A sign points to something else. So John would serve as a sign for Jesus. Because John was pointing not to himself but to Jesus. Are you with me? So a sign is something that reflects something else, that points to something else. The moon has no light of itself, but reflects the light of the sun. So the moon then is a sign of the sun, but it is not the sun. So if Jesus did signs, if Jesus is the light, and as the light, he performed signs, what are those signs pointing to? Those signs are pointing to the true light that lights the world. The light that can light your life and mine. The kind of light that can allow you in the face of a pressing problem to pray about it and go to bed. The kind of light that can allow you to have a different perspective on a problem or a situation that everybody else is stressing about. And the reason why I'm saying all of this as I conclude is that these signs are not there for religious notes. The book of John itself was written as an evidence-based collection of signs for a particular purpose. John says, but these signs are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. In him is life, and the life is the light of men. So brothers and sisters, in the face of your present situation, circumstances, and condition, whatever you face, what you need to navigate your way is the light of God, which is Jesus. And to as many as believe him, to them gave he power to become children of the light. May God bless you. Let us rise for the singing of the hymn of response. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Be all else but nothing except what thou art. Be thou my best thought in the day and the night, both waking and sleeping, thy presence.